Good morning. I am Margarita Rivera, the Vice President of Information Security, Risk, and Compliance for Lennar Multifamily Communities.
Margarita, thanks so much for joining us on the Ivy Podcast today. Before we start talking about your current role and, you know, the things you're building and innovating, I want to spend a little bit of time getting to know you a little bit better. Can you share with us your background, kind of your career timeline, any highlights? We'd love to hear.
Oh, absolutely. Well, John, thank you so much for inviting me to, you know, share with you today and have some conversations. You know, really excited to be able to have these interactions. I would say that my career path, my background is probably one of the most untraditional. I always say that cybersecurity was my accidental career, and in a good way. I mean, it was a positive accident. So my undergrad was in business administration. And immediately out of college, began working for a financial institution in the area of risk management. And at that time, many, many moons ago, where information security and cybersecurity were better known as data security, that particular realm was within the risk management umbrella. And being a financial institution, they were going through all kinds of audits, which financial institutions tend to do. Throughout the entire year. And the data security officer at that time was quite overwhelmed and needed some help. And I was the, you know, freshly out of college, eager, hungry, driven associate on staff. And they were like, okay, we need you to help. And that's how it kind of all began. He became one of my greatest mentors. I kind of fell in love with the whole world of data security and information security. And continued on, you know, kind of in a dual role, supporting him, really learning on the job, as well as doing my operational risk management roles. About 2 years into that, the bank is sold. And, you know, you have to make that decision of, okay, what am I going to do now? Like, what role, what path do I go? Do I stay in operational risk? Or do I venture to go into something that I really didn't go to school for, but that I absolutely love? And at that time, you know, my mentors were like, Margarita, this is the future. You know, technology is everything, and information security, cybersecurity is only going to be that much more important in the next 10 to 15 years. If you have a passion for it, pursue it, you will make a career out of it. And they were spot on. So I went back to school, got a bunch of certifications, continued along that path, and every role just continued to grow and to learn. I'm kind of a nerd, so I love to read and I love to study and to learn from others. So, I mean, 16 years later, I am, you know, doing what I do, what I love, leading the information security program in our organization, and have learned just so much. And even now, currently working on my master's in information security management, and excited just to see, you know, what's ahead. I feel that in our field, anybody that's in technology, you're constantly learning, constantly growing, constantly pivoting, just because the landscape is always changing. So it's been interesting, but I'm so grateful. I never would have thought that I would be where I am today, but I'm so glad of the decisions that led me to this point.
Well, that's pretty cool. What a background, and thanks for sharing some of the personal story with us. It's very interesting. And just from that, it's very unusual. You were right about that. From information security standpoint, what really piqued your interest to go into that particular field? Because it's very unique, very niche, and at the same time, it's very difficult. It's very challenging. So just want to hear a little bit more about that.
Yeah. So I will say this before I answer that specifically. I think that because I had a business background, because I understood, you know, business acumen, it really kind of catapulted my career in the sense that I wasn't just a technical jargon person. I was a person that understood the business pain points. And for me, I think what really just kind of sparked, you know, that interest in information security was the fact that it was so chaotic. Chaotic in a positive way. I mean, it's always changing. And I love that. Like, you're always having to stay a step ahead. You're always having to learn something new. You're always having to, it's like a puzzle, so to speak. You're always thinking of new ways and new strategies in order to tackle whatever's in front of you. I mean, really, you're working against, you know, hackers and people that are out there that are trying to do bad things and that are constantly coming up with ways to do harm to your organization. So being, you know, on the other side and having to think that way, and having to think of new ways and new strategies and things to do to protect your organization, to protect data assets. For me, it was like, wow, this is so interesting. Like, it just really piqued my interest because it wasn't monotonous. You know, a day in the life of a security professional is never the same. A year in the life of a security professional is never the same. There's always something shifting, pivoting, and that keeps you on your toes. And perhaps I'm a glutton for punishment, but I like that. I thrive in those environments. And I know many of my colleagues do as well. So I think that's what for me was what really kind of like just opened my eyes. Like in other areas, initially when I began my studies, for example, I began in accounting and, you know, not to knock accounting, accountants are fantastic, but it's very repetitive. And that did not pique my interest. In information security technology, it's not repetitive. There is always something changing. There's always a threat landscape change. There's always a new technology. There's always a new risk that you have to mitigate. And I like that. I like being able to work with the business in order to determine, you know, the best course of action.
Yeah, no, wow, that's really cool. And kind of understanding the backstory about, you know, things evolving. I think it's an understatement, especially in technology, in software engineering, and in information security, and so forth. And it's, you know, that's very interesting how you chose that path. And so speaking of, you know, innovation and the different trends and things that do evolve, what are some of the, you know, whether that's in information security or information technology in general, what are the different trends and ideas that really excite you these days? What are you passionate about? What are you researching? Perhaps what are you looking to invest in further? Curious to get your take on what you think is the next big trend is.
Sure. Oh my God, there's so many. Where do I start? Not to mention that we just went through, you know, 18 months of COVID, and that's completely changing, you know, the world and our industry and technology and security. I mean, it has been a whirlwind. It's so funny because when we started in 2020, my team and I, we sat down and, you know, we typically do our planning sessions and you get your roadmaps together and you're trying to prepare for what the year is going to look like. And, you know, 3 months in, you're like tearing the roadmap and you're like, okay, what are we doing now? Because everything has changed. I mean, the securing of the remote workforce has been huge for every organization because everybody has to work from home. And the reality is that as we transition into some sense of normalcy, I don't foresee that as changing. You know, we're still going to have to find, you know, creative ways to ensure data protection, considering that a lot of the workforce may never really completely go back into, you know, the corporate setting. So, you know, how do we ensure that we're connecting appropriately with our associates? How do we make sure that we're educating them now that they're not in a corporate setting, that they're in a more relaxed setting of their home and where their guard may be down a little bit more? You know, those have all been things that for us are newer concepts that we're having to look at. In general, I think that as we were coming into 2020, we were really seeing an uptick in data privacy legislation and data privacy controls. At another level, just because of things like, you know, GDPR and things like CCPA, you know, privacy is becoming a really huge hot topic. And I feel like COVID kind of came in and things kind of simmered down a little bit just because the focus was all to that. But I think that now as things are starting to stabilize, the synergies between security and privacy management and the management of consumer data are just going to continue to evolve and are going to continue to be at the forefront. Like, I really see privacy becoming like that spotlight in terms of, you know, the topics and the focus. I mean, right now, I think we have about 11 or 12 states that currently have privacy legislation submitted to committee that are being reviewed, that are being discussed. We already have 4 states that have approved privacy laws. Hopefully from a federal perspective, we'll see something so that there is some kind of synergy between states, but that has an impact on how we do things from a technology perspective and how we do things from a security perspective. So I think that we've always had the responsibility to secure that data, to ensure that people's data is kept private, But now giving so much responsibility and rights to the consumer, it changes the game and it changes how technology has to be built, set up, and actually vetted. So I definitely see a lot of changes, in that area.
Oh, absolutely. And especially, you nailed it on the head with information security, everything shifting to remote and virtual space. I think that just elevated the need to continuously, evolve and come up with, different ways to do things, especially from innovation standpoint. I'm pretty sure you guys experiment on a daily basis. And which leads me to another question that I have for you as far as kind of building and fostering that culture of innovation within your organization or within your department, within your team. I know it's a very loaded question, but share with us any practical strategies that really help you to continuously foster that culture of innovation.
Sure. I mean, I'll be honest with you, John. I am a huge proponent of leveraging, risk methodologies, because I think that if you truly can employ those practices in a very lightweight, fast, efficient way, then you're giving the business the opportunity to do what they need to do in a very fast fashion. I mean, I think that right now, more than ever, everyone is trying to innovate, move fast, stay relevant. But how do you do all that and do that in a secure fashion? So innovation is obviously, a core discipline for any organization that wants to stay relevant, but then making sure that you're making the correct decisions, that, make sure that the risk and the reward align and that you're not introducing undue risk into your organization, I think has been really important. So we've really established great relationships, with our business folks, with those folks that, are sitting down and are strategizing on what's next and what do we do and how do we pivot? Because, I mean, we were going through that already, introduced COVID, and now it's like, at a whole nother level. But mitigating those risks and managing those risks and making sure that the appropriate decisions are being made is really important, I think, for any organization. So I really don't think that we've adopted any new innovative way of approaching these things. But I do think that we have scaled down in accordance with, the asset value, the criticality of the asset, and what the actual scope and volume of whatever the initiative is. So I think that's been really, really important for us. And it's helped us, just to be able to be more expedient and to really align to what the business needs to do. I think that in general, and I'm sure you've heard this before, and I'm sure you've seen this before, security is not typically seen as an enabler. They're typically seen as someone that kind of slows things down. And I'm very passionate and have always been very passionate about dispelling that or transitioning that or changing that, because that's very archaic, a very archaic approach. I want to be running right there with, our business, whatever our business is thinking about, whatever new idea they're thinking about, that's really going to catapult our business model to the next level. Okay, well, let me run with you. And, it's not going to be no. It's okay, well, let's try this and let's try that. And let's, figure out a very collaborative way that you can get done what you can do to make the business successful, and where I can make sure that my team and I are protecting the information assets. So collaboration is key. Socialization is key. Partnership is key. Really dispelling everything that has to do with, there's this old adage of, there's IT and then there's the business. Well, no, we're a part of the business too, because we impact that end result. So really having those synergies and being a part of the conversations and a part of where we need to be as an organization.
Right, I love that. And it's almost resonates, because what you're talking about is the concept of, walking the walk. Mm-hmm. Everybody has great ideas. Everyone has, at the end of the day, taking action and executing and being able to experiment and creating the environment where your team members or the people, your employees feel empowered to take that action, and knowing that, their action, their ideas will be heard and will be considered. I think it's one of the, key ingredients to really foster that culture of innovation. So definitely thank you for sharing that.
Oh, I couldn't agree with you more. And I think that I always like equate it to kind of like Formula One, you know, like Formula One, they want to just go fast and the business wants to go fast. Well, we are like the seatbelts and the deformable structures. We provide that security, that safety for them to be able to go at the speed that they need to go. And that's how I see our team. And that's really like how we try to project to our organization so that they understand that, hey, we're not trying to be that roadblock. We're just trying to give you the seatbelt and the formidable structure. So if something were to happen, you're safe.
Right. Absolutely. So speaking of team, as an executive, I'm pretty sure surrounding yourself with A players, with the best of the best, is at the top of your mind 24/7, whether
you're top of all of our minds.
Exactly. Whether you're actively recruiting or inactively talking to somebody, you always, you know, I'm pretty sure you always evaluate, is this, you know, the type of person I want next to me on my team. So on that point, I have a couple of questions around your strategies to attract the top talent. And also when it comes to interviewing, you being an exec in information security, I'm sure candidates go through multiple rounds, assessments, and so forth. But when they get to interview with you, give us a glimpse of interview with Margarita. What are you, do you keep it very traditional? Do you get creative? What types of questions you like to ask? And more importantly, what do you look for in some of the responses when you talk to candidates?
Sure. So I don't think I'm the traditional. I don't take the traditional approach. For me, soft skills are really important. And I mean, you can find tons of people with technical skills, but soft skills are special. And I want to make sure that those folks that are on our team, not only have the technical aptitude to do what they need to do, but also are, you know, empathetic, are team players, are a right fit for our culture, are collaborative. Those things are really, really important. Typically, you know, in interviews, you know, kind of going back to interview seasons and thinking about all that, I mean, I want to know about that person. And I always open anytime I start with an interview, it's just very similar. I want to know their background. I want them to explain to me how they got to where they are today. Because I think that story says a lot, you know, when you start hearing whether they started in computer science to begin with, or maybe they started in a different realm and how things transitioned. It tells you a lot about the hunger, the drive, and the mindset of the person as they're telling you, you know, their story. So a lot of my questions are not as direct, but they're more open-ended to try to really understand, you know, the mindset of the person. I love asking questions about, you know, talk to me about your biggest failure. That's going to tell me a lot about you, your humility, your ego, and how you dealt with things. Because the reality is, in our jobs, we're going to have moments where we may not succeed. We may not hit the goals that we intended. Well, you know, how did you manage that? Are you okay with failing? Because, you know, failure serves as an opportunity to learn new things and to grow. So I ask, you know, questions that may be a little bit more difficult. I think that's probably the one that people struggle with the most, where I see the pause and the think, and, you know, they try to like give you the failure that they can kind of twist. But I love seeing it. I mean, I've had interviews where folks are like, I've never failed. And I'm like, okay, if you've never failed, you've never worked. Like, we've all had things not go the way we intended. And that's okay. You have to be okay with that.
Right.
I also really, you know, love to see folks that are versatile, that are flexible, that are not afraid to roll up their sleeves. Because within tech, there's going to be highs and lows. There's going to be days where they're going to be 12-hour days, or there'll be days that are, you know, normal. So, you know, how willing and how committed are you to that? For me, professional development and the hunger for professional development is a very important thing. I want to have a team, and I have a team that looks to grow, because in this industry, things are constantly changing. So if you are content with what you know, and you think that you have reached your pinnacle, you're probably not for my team, because we're going to constantly be growing. We're going to constantly be learning new technologies and new methodologies and new ways of doing things. So, you know, those to me are just very, very important, you know, key things. I like to take folks out. Let's go have coffee. Let's go have lunch, you know, kind of try to set people at ease. Interviewing is kind of nerve-wracking to begin with. We've all been there. So I really like to just try to have people feel comfortable so that that way they can respond at their best, to give them the opportunity to do that.
Right. No, I love that. I love those examples. And at the end of the day, it's also an opportunity to allow the candidate ask you the questions mm-hmm. you want to ask, and for them to make that assessment, is this the right type of leadership I want to be under? Correct. Is this the right type of environment? So I love the what you're talking about, really opening that up and making a two-way conversation versus just, you know, the interviewer asking the questions of the employee and trying to make an assessment through that short conversation if it's a right fit or not.
Yeah.
And that's, you know, those are great examples to be able to go outside of just normal traditional interview environment. And one other thing that I want to add is I see a lot of that is companies hiring more kind of for that. What is that lack of weakness or things that we can tolerate, mm-hmm. focus more on that versus focusing more on what is the strength that we're missing on the team and really try to focus on hiring for that particular strength versus lack of weakness.
I think
kind of that type of framework that really at least helps me from a standpoint surrounding myself with the right people.
Absolutely. I think also having diversity within your team. I mean, I don't want everybody that thinks like me. You know, I want folks that don't think like me, that are going to sit down with me and are going to challenge how I think, and that are going to be open to me challenging their line of thinking. I think that that just makes for such a powerful dynamic where you can respectfully have conversations that just make you so much better. So we all grow together. I mean, if I had an exact duplicate of margaritas along my team, I think it might drive me nuts. I need people that I can feed off of, that we can, you know, work together and think different things. It makes for such a more complete team. So I embrace that. I embrace diversity of, you know, ages and backgrounds and cultures and, you know, ways of thinking. It just makes for a better team, more balanced.
Sure. And speaking of diversity, and is a topic that I want to touch upon with you. It's highly requested. And I personally don't like to label things such as, you know, female executive or female board member. There's no such thing. It's just you are an executive or, you know, you are a board member. But, you know, unfortunately, that still exists. And mm-hmm. what I want to get from you for our, you know, for our female listeners, in the sense, I know it's very broad and general topic, but anything that you can share in the sense that really helped you to progress through that career path, and especially, you know, information security, which is, you know, very niche, very, very advanced and very, you know, complicated space for you to kind of to grow through the ranks, gets to the executive level, as well as manage the work-life balance. What are some of the recommendations that you may have that, you know, you can pinpoint as very high level recommendations?
Well, first, thank you for that. It's refreshing to hear that we're not labeled, and that we're just who we are, you know, tech executives, tech board members, whatever it is that we're doing, you know, within our realm. So I appreciate that. I know all the women listeners appreciate that too. I would say to start off with work-life balance, because I think that that's something initially early on in my career, where I was like, okay, work-life balance. You hear it so much. And there's such a drive for work-life balance. And I'll be honest, and this might sound weird and it might cause some friction, but I honestly don't believe in work-life balance in its traditional sense. I kind of dispelled the work-life balance, because to me, in my mind, work-life balance was, okay, I'm going to work for 8 hours and I'm going to come home and I'm going to be 4 hours with my family. And then I'm going to sleep for 8 hours. And it's like, you're trying to compartmentalize so many things. And when I stopped thinking about the balance and just started thinking about really just quality into everything that I do, you know, if it's time for my family, I have 3 beautiful little girls, and I'm a mama first, you know what I mean? Like, I do what I do, I'm an executive, I'm very happy in what I do in my job, but when I'm home, I'm mama first, and everything that they need to grow and to develop is a priority. But when I'm at work, it's 110%. Like, whatever I'm doing, I'm giving my all. I feel like as women, especially women that have, you know, children, we struggle so much trying to work-life balance that we get caught up in the concepts, which frustrates us because we feel like We're never doing enough. We're never able to do enough. And that limits us. So I've just removed that pressure completely. Like, if I get to do something today, I get to do it. If I don't get to it, it's okay. But the most important thing in my priorities are making sure that my kids are happy, healthy, have what they need, and that I'm doing what I need to do, you know, from a work perspective. Work hard, play hard. You know, when I'm at work, we have our deadlines. I have a team. We work together to do what we need to do. And it's okay if there's other days where they're a little bit more down and we can leave at 3 o'clock and go spend extra time with our family. So, you know, we do what we need to do in order to try to create that balance, but without that pressure of that notion. I feel like early on for me, it was really, really debilitating, so to speak, because you feel all this sense of guilt as you're trying to kind of divide yourself amongst so many competing factors. So I say, you know, removing that guilt, removing that frustration, and just doing the best that you can within the space that you have. So setting clear expectations for work and what you're going to do, setting clear expectations for home and what you're going to do, and really enjoying those spaces and those pockets. It's really about the quality of it, not so much as the quantity of it. And then as far as growing, you know, in your career, I've always been very driven. And, you know, as a woman in tech, which is definitely when I started was a huge minority. I mean, I think nowadays we're about 20 something percent of the workforce. But when I started, I mean, I remember going to conferences or classes and being the only woman in the room, which honestly made me have to work harder. Because initially there was a lot of stigma, woman, you know, in a male dominated industry. So that made me just work that much harder. It made me, you know, study harder, learn harder, and just be present. And I think that any woman that is in the ranks and that is growing, you know, has to be cognizant of that. Like, just, you have to put in the work just like everybody else, and you have to show up and you have to be out there and you have to do the things that you need to do in order to establish yourself as a professional that you are, and not be afraid to do that. I think that as women, sometimes we tend to take the step back and be out of the spotlight, so to speak, because it's a little intimidating to be around, you know, such a male-dominated industry. But when you're confident in what you know and you take the time to prepare yourself, then you hang, you know, with the best of them, whether they're male or female.
Right. No, I love that. And I appreciate you being able to categorize these recommendations in these different segments. I know it's not easy. I know it's a very loaded question.
It's a very loaded question, John.
You know, you did a great job as far as categorizing that and compartmentalizing from the standpoint of work-life balance and career path and all of those great things. I'm pretty sure you and I can probably have a whole episode dedicated to that.
Yes, we could.
But yeah, definitely great insights. So we've covered quite a few different topics, which is great. I'm learning quite a bit myself. And obviously when it comes to learning, I'm pretty sure you read a lot, you consume a lot of information, you study. Yeah. So share with us your content diet. What's in the bookmarks of Margarita? What are you reading? What are you learning? Maybe there's a Twitter profile that you follow. Share with us any links or any sources.
Sure. So yeah, I am a book nerd, 100%. If you were to probably turn my camera around here in my office, you would see bookshelves of books all over the place. I love to read. I'm currently finishing my master's, so there's a lot of material that I'm reading right now that is obviously related to the material that we're covering. But I always have like the my book. You know, there's, again, talking about trying to find, you know, balance. You also need to find time to feed yourself. Right now, I'm currently reading Think Again by Adam Grant. I don't know if you've heard of it. It is phenomenal. It just came out, I think, a couple months ago in February. And it's just really about the power of, you know, rethinking. You know, I think there's like the stigma around, you know, intelligence and what you know, but what about the cognitive abilities to rethink things and to approach things from a different way and unlearn things that perhaps you were taught as you were growing up, but that don't serve you at this point, and the ability to deal with discomfort. I feel that at every stage of your career, you're having to relearn things and pivot and change and transition. And if we get so stuck in the way we used to do things or the way we used to perceive things, then we won't grow and we'll stay stuck. So the book has been fantastic so far. I have not finished it as of yet. It's still under process, but really it has been a book that for me, I'm like, wow, this is mind blowing, because these are things that you kind of know inherently. And then you start reading the book and you're like, yes. So it makes you kind of rethink as you're going through thought process for whatever it is. Maybe you're making a decision on, you know, a strategy for the coming year. You're making a decision, personal decision. You know, how do you approach that? How do you go through that process? And, you know, what external things are influencing that? So the book talks a lot about that. I'm enjoying it very much. I love books that challenge your way of thinking. I think maybe in my next life, I'm going to be a psychologist because I am blown away by the human mind and just the power of it. So a lot of the books that I read and have read and are a part of my library have a lot to do with that, just expanding your brain and really just thinking things, you know, differently and different perspectives. And I just think it's awesome.
Right. No, I love that. I love. Is there one particular book that you always recommend to others, and why is that?
I would probably say I'm a big Malcolm Gladwell fan. I love reading his books. He has a book called Outliers that I love. It's phenomenal. And I love it because it dispels what we are taught in that, you know, there's only a select few that can be amazing and successful and they're born that way. And Malcolm Gladwell talks about really, you know, what makes a person successful and how do you reach your potential? And it could be anybody. It doesn't have to be, you know, the Steve Jobs or the Bill Gates or the LeBron James. Like, granted, they have talent, but you have to know what to do with that. And it's all about consistency and really reaching for your potential. And I like that because I feel that we are all, you know, we all have our God-given talents and our God-given potential, and really just being able to follow through so that it comes to like fruition full on, I think is awesome. So I think that if more people really focused on that and didn't get stuck on what, you know, the media portrays as successful, you would just live such a more rich and abundant life by reaching your potential. So Outliers, Malcolm Gladwell, hands down, one of the best books I've read.
I love it. It's one of my favorite books. So definitely a great recommendation there, Margarita. Again, thank you so much for your time today. I know it was a short but very insightful conversation. Personal learned quite a bit. You and I definitely got to stay in touch. Perhaps we're going to do another episode next year to see how much have transpired, how much have changed, and get your perspective. So definitely thank you for your time today.
Oh, my pleasure. Thank you so much.